Hi, my name is Romesh Senewiratne. Welcome to my YouTube site. I'm just going to today talk a little bit about Sri Lanka and the peace process in Sri Lanka. And in 2002, I developed some suggestions, the steps to pursue for a lasting peace in Sri Lanka, as I saw the situation then. I haven't been, and I still haven't been back to Sri Lanka since 1981, which is a long time ago. I left Sri Lanka in 1976, having only lived there since 1968. I was born in England. I don't understand Tamil at all, and very little Sinhalese. Although I can read Sinhalese script, I can't understand what it means. This was the result of my education, despite having one parent who is actually Sinhalese by birth and one parent who is Tamil. I did learn some Sinhalese in Trinity College. I was forced to, but I studied in the English medium. At that time, Sri Lanka's educational system was divided into three different streams, Sinhalese, Tamil, or English. If you were Sinhalese, you had to study in Sinhalese. If you were Tamil, you had to study in Tamil. And that means according to your nationality or race. If you were Muslim, you were allowed to study in Sinhalese, Tamil, or English. If you were regarded as Berger, meaning a descendant of Europeans and Sinhalese mixed or Tamil mixed, you could study in English. And if you had mixed parentage, such as myself, you were also allowed to study in English. Now, my experience in Sri Lanka was before the so-called ethnic conflict between the champions of a separate state for the Tamil people versus the Sri Lankan government and the majority will of the Sri Lankan people, which is to keep the country united. Now, I came up with this peace plan really in response to arguments with my parents who were very keen for a separate state for Tamil people. I believed that introduction of trilingual education, which was not the situation when I was living in Sri Lanka, could contribute to understanding between the different people of Sri Lanka, and also give some chance for the Vada people or the indigenous people of Sri Lanka, who I presume would not be brought into the equation when there was decision about which half of the country or which part of the country would be Sinhalese and which part would be Tamil. Yeah, I'll read this peace plan for Sri Lanka as it was in 2002 as I developed it. And yeah, please tell me what you think. Of course, since then the Tamil Tigers have been defeated, but I do believe that this peace plan, the points, the 40 points in it, do have still relevance today in 2011. One. Introduction of trilingual education, Sinhalese, Tamil and English in primary schools and secondary schools throughout Sri Lanka. Since then I would also add Sanskrit as an ancient language and a common language in terms of the root of both Sinhalese and Tamil and perhaps of English as well. Two, reforms ensuring redistribution of wealth to needy citizens, self-explanatory. Three, establishment of a higher minimum wage. Four, submission for a new Bill of Rights ensuring cultural and linguistic rights. 5, abolition of the Sinhala Only Act, which was introduced by SWRD Bandaranaike, I believe. And 6, abolition of the Prevention of Terrorism Act, which was has been used to justify all manner of oppression. And 7, abolition of the executive powers of the president. And 8, arrest of those involved in war crimes in Sri Lanka between 1982 and 2002. I'm talking about war crimes on both sides, or all sides as the case may be. 9, prosecution of those involved in war crimes in Sri Lanka from 1972 to 2002. 1972, I was still living there, and there was a what was called a Marxist uprising of the JVP. The enemies kept on changing and multiplying and fighting against each other, but these all constitute war crimes, particularly when civilians are targeted. 10, public investigation and public disclosure of all arms deals made by the government of Sri Lanka. And 11, public investigation and public disclosure of all arms deals made by the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam. 12, and this is, I think, where my peace plan starts becoming significantly different to those that I generally discussed. 1, university-based research and education programs studying the specific health and economic problems of Sri Lanka. 13, re-education of non-indictable members of the Sri Lankan Armed Forces and Police Force based on non-violent means of conflict resolution. 14, refocus of the priorities of the armed forces against international threats. And 15, independent government investigation into the development and use of chemical and biological weapons in Sri Lanka. I'll deal with that or discuss it later. 16, retraining of the medical profession and healthcare workers into peacetime medical care. This is something else that I'll be talking about in a clip later, when I'm talking about what I see as the essential demilitarization of science, including medical science. 17, unarmed United Nations and international observers to inspect sites of massacres and other crimes against humanity, to collect photographic DNA and other forensic evidence. Of course, this should be going on right now, and hopefully it is. There has been a recent report handed to the United Nations Secretary General, apparently showing evidence of war crimes on both sides. 18, this is my favorite suggestion on the peace plan, very contentious, I'm afraid, and that is banning of foreign military imports into Sri Lanka, creating a gun-free and bomb-free state. I made a similar suggestion in 1999 regarding Timor, that Timor become the world's first weapons-free state, and unfortunately I was taken away and locked up for being mad for coming up with such crazy suggestions. Number 19, again, I'll talk about that a little bit later. You can see my YouTube clip called Delusion, which shows some of the images that I was came into my mind through that experience. 19, building of cyclotron facility in Sri Lanka for provision of necessary medical isotopes. The phone has just gone off, so I'll just stop for a sec and I'll